Our Father in heaven, we thank you that you, the awesome God of heaven and earth, you who govern the universe with your mighty wisdom and sovereign power, are right here this minute, caring for us, concerned about our need, and ready to answer our prayer that you would be present in tutoring us by your Holy Spirit. Indeed, although it astounds us, not the least sparrow falls to the ground apart from your will. And so even the seemingly mundane issues with which we wrestle, they are of infinite concern to your loving heart, that we would use them as opportunities to learn greater dependence on you, to learn what the courage is that comes from faith, so that we might depend on you more, that we might walk in the steps, this example that David set for us, and especially David's greater son, even our Lord Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. You know, for most of us, I don't think that there's really much debate about it. Our absolutely favorite hero of the faith, at least in terms of the Old Testament scriptures, the one who is most inspiring to us is this figure of David. David, who was the second king of Israel, the one whom God raised up to take over after Saul's failure. David is, not surprisingly then, one who is frequently mentioned in the New Testament in connection with Jesus. The Messiah, the one who was to come, is announced in terms of his birthplace, that he was born in the city of David. An emphasis that starts all the way back in the book of Micah, because all the descendants of David, all the kings that followed him, starting with Solomon right on down, all of them were born in Jerusalem. No one's born in Bethlehem. It's just a little village, except David. Oh, and yes, David's greater descendant, Jesus Christ, the one prophesied. And so the angel announced the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. He's right in the line of David, with the right to rule over the lives of all God's people. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. And all of this, of course, is just a summation of what the Old Testament prophets repeatedly predicted. That is, the promise that was given to David was then amplified with respect to his offspring in the covenant God made with David in 2 Samuel chapter 7. And based on that, the prophets then continually prophesy a coming Messiah who would not be just another son of David, most of whom were disappointments, but a second David, an escalated David. For example, Ezekiel chapter 34, right before at the same time as the Babylonian captivity, he writes, God promises, I will judge between one sheep and another. I will place over them one shepherd, my servant David, and he will tend them. David had lived and died 500 years earlier, but here's the prophet promising another David to come. He will tend them and be their shepherd. I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David will be a prince among them. Likewise, Isaiah says, a shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. Jesse is the human father of David, Jesse long dead, but now it's going to be like a second David. So we go back to Jesse, he's going to have another David, another shoot, as it were, in this line, a branch that will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the Spirit of counsel and of power, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, and he will delight in the fear of the Lord, and he will not judge by what he sees with his eyes. Very much unlike Saul, Israel's first king, who judged everything by outward appearance. Nor will he decide by what he hears with his ears, but with righteousness he will judge the needy. Justice he will give decisions for the poor of the earth, and he will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and the breath of his lips he will slay the wicked. Well, there are all these prophecies in the Old Testament that build on the life of David. And as we go through these chapters, the story of David having started in the chapter before this, as we go right to the end of the book, all the time we'll be thinking about how the New Testament uses these episodes and then escalates them, takes them to the nth power and applies them to Christ, because the life of David, even in its biographical details, becomes a kind of model for the life of our Savior. No one in the Bible, other than David, is described as a man after God's own heart. That's the description with which he's introduced in 1 Samuel chapter 13, when Samuel the prophet tells Saul, because of Saul's disobedience to the word of the Lord, because he believed too much in numbers, in the overwhelming might of the Philistines versus an army that he was ruling over that was melting away in fear, because he was put off from real faith in the context of that overwhelming weakness of Israel and power of the Philistines, because of that, God is going to raise up a successor, a man after his own heart, who will take over for David and will ultimately have a dynasty that supplants the dynasty that would take over for Saul and supplant his dynasty with David's own dynasty. So when we come to our chapter, you've got to be then prepared to see, whenever you read about David, recognize he's the polar opposite of Saul, and one is often then the foil for the other. Saul is shaking in his boots because of Goliath. David responds as ought to have been the case for Saul. He should have had the same faith that David has and does not. In any case, the introduction we looked at last week, at the very moment that the Spirit of the Lord came upon David in power as he was being anointed by Samuel, the very next verse, the Spirit of the Lord is removed from Saul as he's then given over to an evil spirit that torments him. You can see this contrasting portrait coming along right throughout the text. Well, having said that, then we wonder, well, it just doesn't seem fair. In fact, one of the great theologians of the 20th century, Karl Barth, couldn't quite understand it when he considered the seemingly microscopic sins of Saul, for which he forfeited the throne in God's eyes, compared to the enormous, devastating sins of David. How is it possible that one would be rejected and the other would be a man after God's own heart? And the answer is, well, it isn't just, looking at the sins and seeing, well, which is more serious. I mean, from our point of view, not being able to wait the entire seventh day, maybe stopping short just a few minutes before Samuel would have come, doesn't seem like a big deal. That's the sin in chapter 13. It doesn't seem like a big deal that he would wipe out all the Amalekites, but just save, just one or two, Agag in particular, and maybe kill all the animals, but save a few of the best ones for them. It seems like a minor sin compared to David's, doesn't it? Don't be mistaken, by the way. David's sin is not just those outliers we imagine in the second book of Samuel, where we read about his adulterous affair with Bathsheba and then the way in which he conveniently arranges for the murder of Bathsheba's husband Uriah when he discovers that Bathsheba is pregnant. It isn't just that notorious sin that is the problem for David. In fact, David, long before that, in the first part of Samuel, 1 Samuel, he lies to Ahimelech, the priest at Nob, in chapter 21, and thereby puts the priest and the entire priestly family, 85 priests at Nob, at risk for their lives because he's pretending he was on a mission sent by Saul, and therefore they should help him quickly escape, when in reality he was trying to run away from Saul, who was trying to kill him. And because they were then guilty, although they didn't intend it, of aiding and abetting Saul's worst sworn enemy, David, Saul ordered their death. When the one survivor, Abiathar, comes down to David, he tells David what happened at Nob, how 85 priests lost their lives because of Saul. David could have said nothing. He could have just, if he had said nothing, no one would have thought worse of him. This last week, I don't know if you like into NFL football, but You know, we had like on television this massive outpouring of self-reproach and need for forgiveness, and I made mistakes and so on. And I'm not trying to poke fun of anybody. But you know what is amazing about David? Is that David tells on himself. When he confesses his sins, he's confessing stuff that no one would ever have known apart from him telling them. He tells Abiathar in that text how, I am responsible for the death of your father's whole family. And then presumably he tells them the details of how that was. Apart from that, Abiathar would have never known, would never have known. No one would have known. It was David's deception that put them all into harm's way without their permission. It's the same thing as we go through the rest of David's sins. It isn't just the lying to Ahimelech. His courage fails him, and he humiliates himself before Achish later on in chapter 21. And a little later on, he flirts with rebellion against Saul, even though Saul is the Lord's anointed. And only then is his conscience stricken about it. In a fit of rage, a little later on in 1 Samuel, he decides he is going to get even with Nabal for cheating him. In fact, he swears to God, although only God hears it, that I'm going to kill that man and every one of his family before morning. Until Abigail, Nabal's wife, comes to David and stops him on his way and reminds him that if you're going to do what I suspect you're about to do, you will have an unbearable burden on your conscience that you will never get over. Let God take care of Nabal. And what David does, he didn't have to say anything. He could have said, oh, come on, Abigail. I just was just shooting off steam. You know, I wanted to get his attention, you know, kind of let him know how upset I was. I wasn't going to kill him. Are you kidding? That's murder. Instead, he tells Abigail, apart from what she did by courageously stopping him in his tracks, he would have killed Nabal and all the other men. You know, confessions where you tell the other person things that they would never have found out are confessions to be believed. A heart, tender conscience in this man's heart is what makes him a man after God's own heart. And that is not just one or two examples. There are a long list. We could look at them all, right through the accepting of the condemnation of Nathan. He could have said, I didn't kill Uriah. He just died in battle. But he knew that he had ordered that battle in such a way that Uriah was left stranded in front of the front lines and was, he might as well killed him himself. But it would never have stood up in a court of law, and he never had to tell anyone. Likewise, the census and all the rest of it. The Bible says, if we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You know, 1 Samuel 17 is what everyone thinks about when they think about the courage of David. This, you know, underling, this weakling going up against the mighty Goliath. But actually, even greater courage is exhibited by someone who willingly will acknowledge and confess their sins when they don't have to. There's a kind of faith-based courage there that is almost inexplicable, well, apart from the work of the Holy Spirit. Most of us, you know, would learn so much more from our mistakes if we wouldn't just spend all of our time to cover them up. You know, if we'd be more open and tender-hearted and considerate about acknowledging them to others. Whoever conceals his sin does not prosper, the book of Proverbs says, but whoever confesses and renounces them finds mercy. You know, we're so brazen in our sin and so cowardly in our confessions. Follow the example of David to the end. Don't just think of it in terms of a Malcolm Gladwell version of the little guy against the big guy. The big guy are spiritual battles within. They're not somebody out there that you can target so easily. The real courage that shows in those spiritual battles is something with which the rest of the book is taken up. I think it's also helpful for us to recognize that David's faith, what makes him a man after God's own heart, is the motive with which he goes into this battle. He's not fighting his own battle. This isn't his problem. He's not even in the army. He could easily, you know, just take a look at what's happening, make fun of his older brother, whatever, then go back home, report on how we're in deep trouble. It's not his problem. The insults that were falling on the army don't apply to him. He's not in it. But you know, there's something that the Bible says about the courage of faith that is connected to love. Perfect love, 1 John says, casts out fear. The real motive, the kind of faith that David has, springs from love. Those whom he loved were under attack. The God whom he loves was being mocked. And both those factors have his blood boiling and makes him ready to take on the enemy. I think we see this particularly with his own explanation to Saul as to what he's going to do with respect to Goliath. He says, "The Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine." He takes courage and he applies to this situation his own experience as a shepherd, an actual literal shepherd who had sheep. Believe it or not, in the biblical world, shepherds normally really cared for their sheep. You say, well, how's that? Aren't they just raising them to eat them? They don't raise them to eat them. In the ancient world, although they weren't by some conviction opposed to eating animals or whatever, they didn't have refrigeration. If you felt like a lamb chop, you don't go kill a lamb that has been, you know, nurtured on its mother's milk or eating grain, huge amounts of calories going into him. You get your lamb chop and the rest of the animal just becomes useless and rancid within a couple of days. There wasn't a lot of meat eating in the biblical world except during major festival assemblies like Passover or weddings where large numbers of people could eat the animal in its entirety. Normally, these animals are only raised for the renewable resources. The lambs and sheep were kept because of the desire for wool, for clothes. And the goats were kept because of the desire for goat cheese, I guess, and at least milk. Goat cheese sounds more interesting to me. But anyway, you know, that's why they raised them. And yes, when they finally could no longer function, then they would slaughter them, but not just to have a sandwich. And so love drives out fear. Jesus said, "I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep." The hired hand, guy who's motivated by money, isn't the shepherd who owns the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. And then the wolf attacks the flock and scatters it. The man runs away because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. Oh, maybe he cares a little bit for them, but not where it really counts. "I am the good shepherd," Jesus said. "I know my sheep, and my sheep know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep." When David the shepherd had a sheep that was caught by a lion or a bear, a lioness undoubtedly doing the hunting, and the lions that inhabited Israel in those days were the African lion, 300 and 400 pounds of lion, now having your lamb in its mouth, or an 800-pound Syrian bear that used to inhabit the promised land, having your lamb in its mouth, what would you do? If it's your lamb and you love that sheep, you will do the crazy, you're going to go after that animal and get your lamb back. You know, a woman might be terrified of spiders, I don't know what, but when the little spider is crawling into the crib, suddenly she's as bold as a lion, isn't she? Making sure they protect the little kid. And it's the same. It is a perfect love casts out fear. Love for his fellow Israelites. It's the armies that the Philistine was defying, his invectives, mocking them. 40 days of mocking, and David couldn't stand it any longer. And mocking them means mocking the God of Israel. He couldn't stand that either. He loves God. He can't bear to hear God's name dragged through the mud. That's where the boldness of faith comes. It wasn't that he somehow or other, you know, wanted to, I don't know, step into the limelight, as his older brother thought, and be, you know, flattering, self-flattering. He wasn't conceited. This wasn't about David. It was about the Lord. It was all about the Lord. By the way, Saul would never get that. You can often tell a lot about a person based on how they think other people are motivated. According to the text, when David arrives, the word gets around, everyone's terrified, running away from Goliath because of their fear. And then they say, "Do you see how this man keeps coming out? He comes out to defy Israel." So the king needed to put a little starch in everybody, right? "The king will give great wealth to the man who kills him. He will give him his daughter in marriage and will exempt his father from his father's family from taxes in Israel." It's all about money and status. Marrying into the king's family. Surely you're going to risk your life for that, right? A little more money, a little more prestige. None of that touched David. He could care less. In fact, at the end of the battle, when he now was qualified for the king's daughter's hand in marriage, he says, "I'm not worthy to be married into the king's family, to be a son-in-law of the king." Are you kidding? He wasn't doing for the money or for the prestige. He was doing it for the honor of God. "The battle is the Lord's. You come against me with sword and spear and javelin," he said, "but I come against you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. All those gathered here will know that it is not by sword or spear that the Lord saves, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you all of you into our hands." Well, we could continue looking at David's remarkable example of faith. He meant it to be an example. He knew that this is all those gathered here will see and learn what it means to be a member of the people of God and to have the God of the armies of Israel on your side. They'll all get it. He was an example even to himself, we'll see in one text later on. It was a lesson he forgot himself back in later on in chapter 21. We'll look at that on another occasion. Well, anyway, I want to look at some problems that, as I've been studying this, every year I seem to add a couple more. I found some notes from way back. I only had four to begin with. Now we're up to nine. I added two more on this go. There are nine common misunderstandings that get in the way of a mature understanding of the lesson that God has for us in this text. And having, just kind of saying this to begin with, you might even wonder, are there even nine things in the story? How could there be nine mistakes in our understanding? But actually, I want to first say that the Word of God, that the Bible, as the Word of God written, is something that even the least child can understand. You don't have to be a college graduate or some genius to get it. "Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong." That's a lesson any child can get out of the story of David and Goliath. And by the way, it is not a lesson that Malcolm Gladwell managed to get out of it. He thought it was instead evidence of, well, David's regularly win, according to him, because they're using strategic use of a maneuverable effort. You know what? Anyway, we'll look at that later. You know, that's the lesson, the big lesson. But having said that, those of you who attend church, whether here or anywhere else, frankly, when the outside world doesn't know, when we get into the Word of God and Bible studies and sermons, we dig in, we jump in with both feet, we roll up our sleeves and wrestle with the text. And we to our surprise, sometimes discover that, you know, frankly, familiar truths are not always true. Things that we used to think when we were learning these stories using flannel graphs have some mistakes in them or just misimpressions we got from that. That's okay. We're big boys and girls. We get it. Further study often, you know, disabuses us of misimpressions. The other thing that happens with further study, though, is it oftentimes is a little unsettling because further study does not always bring greater certainty. you discover that there are really three good explanations for this verse, not just one, and you're not sure which one even to pick. They're all great. They're wonderful. So it's not like we're unsettled in our faith. We're only unsettled if what we expected every time we came to church or every time we went to our small group was never to learn a new thing. There actually are some people that have that attitude or something, and I don't know, then it does kind of spoil the day. But here, I think you wonder, well, then why bother to do these sorts of things? Why study? Well, because although familiar truths do not always turn out to be so true, and although greater study does not always prove to be the harbinger of greater certainty, the result is the amazing new insights that are even better than the ones that came based on that familiar approach. There are often rich veins of the inexhaustible riches of God's truth that open up to us, and you could spend the rest of your life mining them. Because the God who wrote nature, also writing his word, naturally, while anyone can understand it, just like anyone can understand the greatness of God looking out on a beautiful day, you could also spend the rest of your life studying just a human cell or a galaxy, and you will never exhaust the truth that's in it. And so is the case with this, because the author is the same, the infinitely wise, creative genius who is the God of heaven and earth. So I do want to look at some problems that are often raised about 1 Samuel 17. First of all is one you may be aware of or not. It's who killed Goliath. There are books out there that are compendia of supposed errors in the Bible. Very often the numbers, usually they're like, they'll come out with 10 or 12. And every time you have a list of these, 1 Samuel 17 is on them. Because there is a supposed contradiction in Samuel. Was it David who killed Goliath, as we read obviously in this chapter? So David triumphed over the Philistine with a sling and a stone, without a sword in his hand. Meanwhile, a champion named Goliath, who has from Gath, has a spear shaft that was like a weaver's rod. I mean, yet, look what happened. It was David. It turns out, however, in the very same book, in 2 Samuel 21, in Hebrew, it's all one book. In English, we divide it into first and second. In Hebrew, it's one book, the same book, says, in another battle with the Philistines at Gob, Elhanan, the son of Jair, or the son of Jaarei Oregim, the Bethlehemite, killed Goliath the Gittite, Goliath of Gath, is literally what that means, who had a spear with a shaft like a weaver's rod. And the question is, what are we to make of that? Is it David or is it Elhanan? Conservative scholars through the centuries have responded that, well, it's possible that it's just a coincidence. Maybe there were lots of Goliaths back then. I mean, how many Bobs are there here in the sanctuary this morning? Bob, raise your hand. I see kind of, but, you know, there may be many Bobs. How many Bobs from Boston? You know, and so there may be many Goliaths from Gath who happen to have a spear like a weaver's beam. But you know, it strains credibility, doesn't it, when we don't read about another single individual's name. Maybe that's special pleading. It feels a little uncomfortable. Another suggestion that conservative scholars have given is that, well, David's parents, when he was born, named him Elhanan. But who wants a name like Elhanan? I mean, that's a very odd name. And anyway, when he became king, he got a throne named David. Just like popes get, you know, Francis, or they get a better name or something that's more meaningful. That also is possible. There are some name changes in the Bible, but when we get them, they are in connection with entering into a covenant, typically. And so it all seems stretched. Then now, on the other hand, are the critical scholars. The critical scholars would argue in university classes on this subject would say, here is the proof that the editor who put together the book of Samuel had multiple different traditions that contradict one another. And because they contradict one another, well, you know, we tend to favor one story, but Elhanan probably was the original guy that killed Goliath. And then because David was king, you know, you need a story to show how great David is. And so you borrow stories and attribute them to David when they really were all about Elhanan originally. That's a typical view of critical scholars in answer to this problem. And you and I might feel like, well, you know, my goodness, it's beyond me. It makes me feel nervous that there's a problem in my Bible, a contradiction, right? You know, but there it is. Or instead of getting all worried and bent out of shape, we could get excited. There seems to be a contradiction. And when you have a contradiction in your study of nature, like, for example, when you're studying the seafloor spreading of the Atlantic and you notice that the orientation of the magnetic fields as you go, almost like stripes, one has north heading this way, one has north heading this way. Instead of burying that contradictory finding in your research and pretending that you didn't see it, or giving some goofy explanation for it, you can roll up your sleeves and do better homework, and you will end up with the entire theory of plate tectonics. You know, suddenly a vein of inexhaustible truth opens up, and amazing insights come because your old theory wasn't good enough and it needed to go. So also here, if you do a little further study, you learn in 1 Chronicles chapter 20 that it says, in another battle with the Philistines, Elhanan, son of Jair, killed Lami, the brother of Goliath, the Gittite, who had a spear with a shaft like a weaver's rod. And this text is clearly quoting the 2 Samuel text, and it follows right along with 2 Samuel 21. And so you think, wait a minute, one says the brother of, that would really make it quite different than if he killed Goliath, right? How can we explain this problem? Well, we explain it because what we have in our Bible are amazingly accurate copies of what must have been the original text. However, the copies are in some cases hundreds, thousands even, in this case, of years after the original. And so sometimes, thankfully, we got so many copies and so many avenues to reconstruct the original, but sometimes minor mistakes do apparently creep in the copying. And if I amplify it so you can see it a little better, you can see what happened. What happened was there is this word up here, meaning the brother of, and there's this word here, meaning nothing. It doesn't mean anything. It tells you the next word is the direct object of the verb. You don't translate it. And apparently, they wrote this in the original, and a copyist was having a cup of coffee, and a little dot dropped, a spill dropped here, and so the guy who copied his copy picked it up and just went on not thinking. And so this is a tiny mistake, admittedly. No one's salvation depends on it. But by doing a little effort, you discover it's a very simple fix. And in fact, newer translations have, in fact, fixed it. And by the way, so have some older ones. Look at your King James Bible, and the King James Version noticed this and fixed it and recognized, reconstructed what, based on all the evidence, what would have been the original and how would these mistakes have been perhaps caused. And we can confirm the correctness of the King James Version and also newer Bibles like the New Revised NIV, the Pew Bible that came out in 2011, by looking at the outline of the end of the book. And I'm not going to spend much time on this right now, but it's a wonderful chapter 21 in 2 Samuel. You have this wonderful concentric ending in the last chapters. And you have a sin of King Saul at the beginning and a sin of King David at the end. You have then a list of the heroes of David that remind you of David and the heroes of David that remind you of David. And in the center is the hero of heroes, which since David wrote it, it's not about him. It's God. God is the hero of heroes. But in this list is where Elhanan is. So you don't expect it to be about David by another name. It's instead one of his wonderful heroes who followed in his example because he took to heart David's battle against Goliath. And he fought in his life a battle against Goliath's brother. You and I can follow Elhanan and do likewise. We can take the lesson of David and apply it to our own lives in our own situation. Let's go on. How about the size of Goliath? The size of Goliath, according to the text, says a champion named Goliath, who is from Gath, came out of the Philistine camp. He was over 9 feet tall, a kind of a big dude. The footnote says 6 cubits in a span. That's a little easier to swallow because we have no idea how big that is. But actually, It's worse than over 9 feet. It's actually 9 feet 9 inches. It should have said a little under 10 feet. But the Pew Bible doesn't translate that way because it's just a little under 10 feet. I mean, you know, it's embarrassing he's too big. He's just so big. Now, God can do anything. He is a worker of miracles. And so Goliath may be a walking miracle. But you know, we don't expect the miracles to be what God does to the enemy, making him bigger. We expect the miracle to be what God does in the life of David, don't you? So if you don't want this to be a miracle, I don't think. It would be a very unusual miracle if it is. And in fact, it would be a miracle because we know at least of the last 10 billion people, 7.3 billion right now, but Robert Wadlow, according to the Guinness Book of World Records, my son reads it and keeps me well informed, apparently, well, there's his younger brother, Eugene, who is 6'6". He was 8 feet, 11.1 inches. He is apparently the tallest human being in recorded history. Right now, there's not another person even close to this on the planet. But my goodness, Goliath, at 9 feet 9 inches would be another whole foot ahead, you know, above. You know, I mean, again, it could be a miracle. Could be a miracle. But do you expect miracles on the part of those who are our enemies? Whose side is God on? Anyway, there is in fact, there are some, my friends are friends of the Wadlow family, and apparently he was the gentlest, most wonderful man. Unfortunately, died at a very young age, somewhere in the 20s, in 1940. I guess he was 22. Anyway, is there anything to be done about it? What about the 6 cubits and a span? Well, it turns out that the entire Greek Bible that we have, where the Hebrew Bible is translated into Greek before Jesus, and in particularly, well, somewhere around the 3rd century BC, and we have copies of it right after Jesus, we have some very old copies of the Greek Septuagint, and it says 4 cubits and a span. That's interesting. And Josephus, who was writing at the time of the Apostle Paul or a little later, he also says 4 cubits and a span. And so we have to decide which is original. One of these can't both be true and original. One must be original. How would you decide? How was there a mistake? Let me talk about how the mistake might have come about. There may have been a mistake caused starting in the 2nd century BC in Hebrew. There was a tendency to start using letters for numbers. If you've ever heard about the Bible code, don't believe a word of it. Because the Old Testament was completely written before this. And during the period in which the Old Testament was written, they did never use letters for numbers. But under the influence of the Greeks who were doing this, Hebrew started doing it too. And you can see that the number 6 and the number 4 in terms of a letter, they are very close. And if you made this one a little shorter or this one a little longer, you'd have the same letter. And these two letters did start getting a little bit confused occasionally. In words, it usually isn't a problem, but for a number, it is a problem. And that might have explained that one of them was original, the other one was a mistake, an honest mistake. In earlier script, it would be the same problem. If you made this line a little bit longer, it would then connect, and then it would look exactly like this. So these were letters that could be confused occasionally. And when they stand in a word, it's no problem because, well, it wouldn't normally be a problem. The rest of the word would keep you straight. By a number, it's a little more open to difficulty. I'd like to suggest that actually the 4 cubits in a span is correct, that Goliath was 6 feet 9 inches tall, which is extraordinarily tall when you remember that in the biblical world, in Israel, the average height for men, some scholars would say was 5 feet, some say 5 feet 3 inches, some would make it a little taller, but 5 feet 3 inches, let's go with that nice conservative estimate. Do we have anyone here this morning who's 5 feet 3 inches? 5'3", 3 inches. How about right there? Would you come forward? I you didn't know that I was going to do that, did you? And now let's get Goliath. Let's assume, by the way, while we're waiting on this, by the way, we now have a Hebrew text, the oldest of by 1,000 years older than the oldest text we had before, that was found in Qumran, the Dead Sea Scrolls, that has 4 cubits in a span. So the oldest Hebrew Bible has it. So I think it's 6'9" is the one to go with. Anyway, so let's get 6'9". Where's it? Who do we have that's 6'9" here in the sanctuary? You come on up right here. David, I need you to be right close. In fact, you can be down on the ground. It'll be good. And anyway, 6'9"? No, not. Don't be embarrassed. How about 6'8"? 6'7"? You got to make it. 6'7"? Ha! Ah, come on, right down. We'll wait for you. Great. All right. You're going to need to stand down there. I mean, I just want you to see what this looks like. Okay? And, you know, 5'3" was typical, average. That would mean, I'm not going to talk about weights or anything, but, you know, 125 pounds or something typical weight for a male of that size. 6'9", typical weight is between 250 and 340, so you're a bit of a wimp, but you come over here. Stand over here, because you need elevator shoes in order to get up to that 6'9", don't you? Okay, now make a mean face at David, would you, Goliath? You know. Does that look scary? Do you know why an entire army tried to find a reason not to fight? Because this is scary. And you're now also having all weaponry, and you've got... Okay, thank you very much. Thank you for your... Okay. All right. All right. What is my point in pointing this out? Well, we tend to exaggerate our enemies. This is why it's not only accuracy that I want to have at 6'9". Most of us try to psych ourselves out when we have an enemy because it's easier not to fight. The sluggard, Proverbs 22 says, the sluggard says, there is a lion outside, or I will be murdered in the streets. And that makes it possible to stay in and play some more computer games. You know, we make up, we psych ourselves out thinking this is an unbeatable foe, and we escape. And we do something else so we don't have to tackle the problem. It's a common psychological defense mechanism to do it, to inflate numbers in our enemies and believe the worst, believe they're terribly threatening when they aren't. I had this problem when I was wrestling in high school. I used to wrestle at BBNN. I was not very good. But I didn't know that at the time. I thought actually I was very good because my coach regularly had me wrestling at 2 weight levels above my weight. I thought, gee, you know, I must be amazing. You know, I'm asked to fight guys that are like huge, right? Well, it's just because he didn't want to waste a good fighter, you know, on a somebody that he knew we would not be able to beat. So I was fodder. But one day I was wrestling, I think it was a guy from Belmont Hill, and you know, my main idea was, how can I lose gracefully? How can I look like I was struggling and then he pinned me but I couldn't get out of it or something like that, right? I didn't want to get hurt. As I was going through this and allowing this guy to start beating me, the coach screams into the mat, Gordon, you beat this guy last year. I mean, I'm talking about a guy who has arms that look like my thighs. Apparently, he was just no good at wrestling. He could have crushed me, but he wasn't able to beat me. And so all of a sudden, strength came into me, you know, knowing that I beat him last year. And sure enough, I actually won. No one was more surprised, all right? I'd say this is the problem with psyching yourself out. You end up being defeated even by those enemies, those spiritual battles that you should have won. In fact, we have a promise. No test has seized you except what is common to man. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tested beyond what you can bear. But when you are tested, he will also provide a way out so that you can stand up under it. David didn't think he was the only one who could have taken on Goliath. He just can't understand why no one else has already done this. It's astonishing to him. And it isn't because, well, he's someone who has mastered the art of using a sling or something, the only slinger there. If the army was there, there were many slingers there that day. He's the only one who was willing not to be blinded by outward appearance and to actually take on the enemy. Anyway, I want to move just to one more, and then I'll dash off, okay? How about, it's 3 out of 9, we'll do the others 2 weeks from now. 2 weeks we'll come back and do, honestly. But I do want to talk about the age of David. How old was David? Saul replied, "You're not able to go against this Philistine and fight him. You're only a boy, and he has been a fighting man from his youth," or boyhood. It's the same word, only with hood on the end of it. Well, you know, how old is David? It all depends on what Sunday school class you're teaching. You know, he's 7 or 8 if it's 2nd or 3rd grade, right? Right? I get it. And 10 or 11 if he's 5th or 6th grade. I've done it too. I, however, want to warn you. I did this at the Wellesley Baptist Church teaching a 6th grade class. I'm getting all excited about, you know, David and Goliath and telling the story. And I get to this point, and I reminded them that, you know, David was surprised. No one else would fight. You know, here the king had given all these rewards, and you know, if you win, you get to marry the king's daughter. And one of the boys looked up at me and said, "Well, no wonder no one wanted to fight." So there are problems then underestimating his age, aren't there? When David turned down the offer of marriage, he doesn't say, "I'm not old enough to get married." He said, "I'm not worthy to become the king's son-in-law." It wasn't that I'm not interested in girls. In fact, there was one who was interested in, the sister, Michael, named Michael. Anyway, all I can say is, well, then what are we to imagine? You know, we can sometimes, in self-deprecation, you know, false humility, underestimate what God can and has already done through us. And so it doesn't help to minimize this business of age. The Bible says you're a boy, na'ar in Hebrew. Say na'ar, would you please? A na'ar. You're a na'ar. Say that. Na'ar. Yeah. You're a boy, a na'ar. But the question is, what is a na'ar actually? We know Absalom was a na'ar, according to 2 Samuel 14, when he raised a rebellion against his father and led an entire army to take over Jerusalem. That's a na'ar. And as we go through this, we're going to realize, well, wait a minute, Rehoboam was 41 years old when he was a na'ar, a boy. Wait, what kind of crazy youth medicine do they take? You know, well, a na'ar is any man who does not yet have a son or dependents that depend on him. Like Abraham, admittedly, didn't have any children until he was 85, but because he had an army of 318 men who were born in his household, he's not a na'ar. You can be a father of a multitude in terms of your influence. But when you are a dependent, rather than having many depend on you, including children, then you are a na'ar. So David could be easily 41, or he could be Absalom's age, or Eli's sons, who, by the way, were committing adultery or abusing the women sleeping with them who serve at the temple. So I just say, get rid of this picture, because it's just totally misleading. The problem is not helped by exaggeration. David was not just a child. Think about not only the fact when Saul tried to clothe him, he didn't say, "These don't fit." He said, "I'm not used to them." Saul's armaments fit fine. I mean, maybe they were an L and he took an M, but he wasn't like S, double S or whatever. You know. Anyway, his previous accomplishments, he says, David said to Saul, "Your servant has been keeping his father's sheep. When a lion or a bear came and carried off the sheep from the flock, I went after it. I struck it and rescued the sheep from its mouth. And when it turned on me, I seized it by its hair, struck it and killed it." This is hand-to-hand combat. It's not all missile contact, you know, combat. We're not just talking about distance fighting with slings. Hand-to-hand combat with this animal, apparently, as I say, that is pretty amazing. It was not an issue of his ability. It was an issue of his availability. Paul writes, "Brothers, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards, not many influential, not many of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. He chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify those that are, so that no one may boast before him. He wanted all Israel to know that nothing can save, nothing can hinder the Lord from saving, whether by many or by few. He wanted the whole world to know that there's a God in Israel. That's the takeaway from this story. That it is not by sword or spear or even by sling that the Lord saves. For the battle is the Lord. Whatever we put at his disposal, he'll use, and he will have the victory. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we pray that you would enable us to not so defeat ourselves in terms of our exaggerated view of the enemy or our minimizing view of what you've already accomplished in our lives and are capable of doing. My goodness, Lord, you've made us new creatures in you. You've done the most miraculous thing of all. You've given us life when we were dead in trespasses and sins. You caused us to be born again. You've changed us inside and out, and you will continue to change us if we will just yield to you, surrender our lives to you, and fight the battles to which you are calling us in the strength you supply. We thank you. You make your strength perfect in our weakness. Do so this day for the sake of your own honor and glory, we pray. Amen.